Welcome to this episode entitled Hypertrophic Cardiomyopathy, Identifying Symptoms and Confirming the Diagnosis. I am Sara Saberi. I'm the co-director of the Inherited Cardiomyopathy Program at University of Michigan. And I'm going to talk with you a little bit today about recognizing the diagnostic pathways and referral pathways for your patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in order to help you communicate those with your patients, their families, and caregivers. But cardiomyopathies are a general class of heart muscle disorders. Here I'm showing you pictures of what the heart can look like, with the leftmost picture being a depiction of the structurally normal heart. Cardiomyopathies are very highly variable at the diagnosis age. They're all associated with heart muscle changes and electrical conduction abnormalities or arrhythmias, and most are genetic. Here you can see that hypertrophic cardiomyopathy involves thickening or hypertrophy of the left ventricle, typically the left bottom chamber of the heart. Dilated cardiomyopathy actually involves thinning of the heart muscle and dilation of the ventricle, enlargement of the cavity. Non-compaction cardiomyopathy involves these muscle trabeculations or kind of lacy formations of the heart muscle, usually towards the tip of the heart, that results in a dysfunction in its squeeze capabilities. And then arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy, which typically tends to involve the right ventricle, but our understanding has expanded to understand that it can involve both ventricles. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, as we touched on, is really characterized by heart muscle thickening or hypertrophy. That thickening results in stiffening and scar tissue formation that really hinders the left ventricle's ability to relax or fill with blood. The left ventricle displays often a normal or greater than normal squeezing force, and that can sometimes result in obstruction to blood flowing out of the left ventricle. It's the most common genetic heart muscle disorder, occurring in about 1 in 500 people worldwide. It has no discrimination based on ethnicity or race or gender. There are several ways in which people with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy can come to medical attention. Some people have symptoms such as shortness of breath, or dyspnea, chest pain, lightheadedness, some pass out, and some have palpitations. Some people have no symptoms whatsoever and are picked up because of a family history of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy or unexplained sudden death, or even a family history where people will say that there were early heart attacks in the family, where our understanding of what heart attack at that time meant was probably sudden death or cardiac arrest that was presumed to be due to a heart attack or coronary disease. Some people are detected to actually have a murmur on their physical exam or the cardiac exam, and that leads to further investigation, or abnormalities are found on EKG such that left ventricular hypertrophy is suspected. There may be repolarization changes for axis deviation or Q waves found on the EKG. Ultimately, the diagnosis is made by imaging, which involves either echocardiography or cardiac MRI, both of which are important tools in finding key features of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. The diagnosis is really established when there is thickening of the heart muscle of at least 15 millimeters in any segment of the left ventricle, in the absence of another cause that can explain that burden of thickening or hypertrophy. Normal muscle thickness in the left ventricle does depend on gender. So in women, it's under a centimeter, about 9 millimeters is the upper limit of normal in women. And in men, it's up to about 11 millimeters. You can diagnose hypertrophic cardiomyopathy with a limited amount of thickness of the heart muscle, about 13 millimeters or so, when there's a presence of a family history of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, or if that person already carries a disease-causing genetic variant and mild thickening is detected. Like I said, many individuals have no symptoms at the time that they're diagnosed, and they're picked up with murmur or an incidental finding on EKG that's abnormal, or for family screening purposes when someone has said that they have a family member that has HCM, and then they themselves come for evaluation to make sure that they're having the appropriate imaging evaluations to look for evidence of HCM. Other people present with shortness of breath or chest discomfort, palpitations, lightheadedness, fatigue, or kind of an inability to have the energy that they want to be able to do the things that they want to do is a common symptom. Fainting or syncope is unusual, and very rarely cardiac arrest may be the initial presentation in some patients with HCM. Usually the diagnosis comes first with doing imaging echocardiography at rest, where we actually take pictures of the heart from all different angles and assess not just the thickening of the chambers, but also the function. We're looking at the valves and how they function. And importantly, in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, because there can be obstruction to blood leaving that left ventricle, it's important to do imaging where we're doing maneuvers to try to provoke finding of the obstruction. And so that kind of cardiac imaging is really considered standard of care for the diagnosis of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And because echocardiography is really very readily available across all different kinds of clinical care delivery situations, it's the first line imaging modality. If echocardiography is inconclusive, then cardiac MRI is a reasonable imaging modality to move to. And so here you can see that echocardiography is really an imaging system that involves ultrasound, where a probe is placed on the outside of the chest, and we're trying to image the heart through that probe that's on the outside of the chest, versus cardiac MRI, that is a big kind of tubular scanner that uses magnetic fields in order to be able to image the heart. Cardiac MRI is particularly useful for identifying the maximal wall thickness because the imaging resolution is so great. And it's particularly useful when there's kind of discrepancies around the maximal wall thickness at either the clinical diagnostic end of the spectrum around 15 millimeters or prognostic end of the spectrum around 30 millimeters, where that particular cutoff is used to kind of identify somebody who may be at higher risk for rhythm abnormalities that may be dangerous to them. The inheritance pattern of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is autosomal dominant. And this is what I was referring to when I said that HCM really doesn't discriminate based on gender or ethnicity or race. It affects men and women equally. And what I'm showing you here is a pedigree. So this is a three-generation family history that we depict in terms of an image. So the person that is the patient that's in front of us is indicated with an arrow right here. Men are indicated by squares and women indicated by circles. And each one of these rows is a different generation in the family. And so this patient of ours is married to this woman and has three children through that relationship, two daughters and a son. He has a brother and a sister, and then these are his parents. So we can see that our patient was diagnosed with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy around the age of 30 and has a defibrillator. And what we're depicting is that each of his siblings has a 50-50 chance of developing that same hypertrophic cardiomyopathy from carrying the same genetic change that is responsible for the disease. His family history is a little bit suspicious because his father died of a stroke at the age of 42, a pretty young age to die of a stroke. And then his daughter has borderline thickening of the heart muscle, a little bit more than what would normally be expected for a young woman her age. And so she's also being assessed. Carrying the genetic variant that can cause disease does not mean that somebody will actually develop disease. So this is a concept called penetrance, meaning that the genetic change may result in a variable kind of distribution or presentation of the disease, ranging from none at all to very mild to very severe. And we don't have great ways of predicting that. An identifiable disease-causing genetic change is found in about 50 to 60% of people with a cardiomyopathy. So genetic testing can be really helpful in that way, in not just informing the patient about what's going on, but importantly, about informing the rest of the family about ways in which they can think about their own risk for developing disease in the future. Why it's important for us to have early diagnosis and recognition of the disease is because the long-term consequences of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy are not small. So atrial fibrillation is a common rhythm abnormality. It occurs in about 4 to 6-fold higher prevalence amongst people with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy than the general population. And without medications to prevent blood clots from forming in the heart in the setting of atrial fibrillation, there's an annual risk of about 10 to 12% of developing a stroke related to atrial fibrillation. There is also a risk of rhythm abnormalities that generate from the bottom chambers of the heart, ventricular arrhythmias that can be life-threatening. These occur much less frequently than rhythm abnormality like atrial fibrillation, occurring less than 1% per year. But of course, we want to be able to identify people who are at high risk for developing life-threatening rhythm abnormalities. And finally, heart failure is a pretty pervasive consequence of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. The relaxation abnormalities that we talked about in the beginning are almost universal. They occur very early in the disease process and result in morbidity, such as daily shortness of breath with activities that can be limiting to people, but also can progress to the point where people have heart failure exacerbations that land them in the hospital. It's unusual to have squeeze abnormalities of the left ventricle. That only happens in about 8% of patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Thank you all for participating in this activity with me today. A lot of important points about the diagnosis of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This activity is supported by an independent medical education grant by Bristol Myers Squibb. The views and opinions in this activity are those of the speakers and reflect the synthesis of science. Content should not be considered as the official policy of the American Heart Association. And to get additional information, please visit the American Heart Association's Hypertrophic Cardiomyopathy website. Thank you.